We basically all have, for under $500 nowadays, the ability to set up a really good little quiet recording area. But the reality is, knowing how to use those tools is just as important, if not as important, as being able to deliver really good, sharp reads. A lot of people send auditions in. I've heard them, and I used to do that early in my career too, until somebody pointed it out and I focused on it for a while and fixed it. But they don't understand when they send those in that they didn't say to, they said to. Huh. They didn't say did you with a Y, they said did you, J-E-W. Yeah. They didn't say get yours, they said get, or yours, they said get yours. The reality is, nobody on that end receiving your audition is going to write you and say, you know, Howard, the reason that we didn't pick you is the guy that we chose over you had better enunciation. So the idea here is to recognize where your dullness is with regards to the lean green voice machine. Now, what does this mean? It means in order to develop and create really good live speech or live voiceover skills in the studio, you have to put all of what we've done together so that the eyes, the mind, the throat, the mouth, the larynx, the diaphragm, everything works in synchronicity with one another. It's like the other day when I was talking to a guy who's doing just a couple focus lessons on this exact area that he has problems with. It's kind of like, you can use your computer as an example. When you are looking at the philosophy of a computer, it's surfing the web. It's downloading record, seeing the data. It's downloading the data to your system. The RAM, or the random access memory, is temporarily ciphering and storing that stuff to your temporary folder on your hard drive. And over the processing that's going on, it's going to, between the RAM, the hard drive speed, the processor, and the overall technical everything, there's different steps that if your machine is slow, or your one of the areas of the machine isn't keeping up with the rest, then you get buffering. Like when you're at YouTube and you're watching a video for the first time, that YouTube, if you don't have a good, fast, fairly decent broadband connection, processing speed, temporary folders maxed out already, you never haven't emptied your cache in forever, you got tons of wasted hundreds of thousands of megs of ridiculous stored files that you're never going to look at. Bottom line is, your stream of that video is going to keep rebuffering over and over.
Yeah.
Once it has downloaded and it is installed temporarily, when you play it a second time, it's going to probably play back somewhat smoothly. And the reason is, it's no longer relying on everything to work in unison. It's just relying on its playback ability. The same thing happens when we're reading. When we're reading, we are processing all of that data into our machine. And that is why I say you can't really own the script until you have rehearsed it dozens of times. Until the mind, like we've talked about, recognizes the familiarity of what you're about to read. Until the internal memory goes, seen this before. Until the RAM goes, oh yeah, I've dealt with this before. Until the hard drive goes, I think we have some of this already in the temporary folder. Until all those departments work as a synchronized warehouse, then and only then can you truly start to sharpen or play with what you're reading. Once you sharpen and play with what you're reading, you should have eliminated all of the slurs, the enunciations, the diction problems, the articulation problems, the dynamic word emphasis, the pronunciation problems, the vocal expression, all the things you're going to go over. I can't tell you how many speakers in my forever years, it feels like I've been working in this industry, go out on the circuit, and within 15 minutes of being on stage in front of a room full of 300 people, lose half the audience to their phones. Half the audience is looking down at their phone, their tablets, they're scrolling through Facebook. They're not really paying attention. And the reason is they don't really want to be there. They're there just because it's required for them to be there by their own, right, by the owners. Whereas if you're a really engaging type of speaker, if you're flamboyant, if you have a lot of personality, a charisma, stage presence, all the stuff that we do as voice talent on the mic, if you do that live on stage, you will not lose the audience. All the training, all the NASA experience, all the stuff that you have brought you to the point in your life of where now it's time to really think, am I really sharpening my tool? Is my tool in need of a really good, like a lawnmower blade, a really good sharpening? Do I cut the lawn or do I really sharpenly cut the lawn? You know, and I know that the sharper you cut a lawn, the slower it grows back. The less dull it is, the more cuts you got to give it. It's the same thing with anything we're using a knife on or a blade on. The same thing happens when I work with people live and they learn how to really work the room. They learn how to work the stage. They understand how to engage the audience. They understand how to move the words. They understand how to use colors. They understand how to be vocally expressive. They understand how to be dynamic. All the stuff that we've trained on, even though it's only been on 7 or 8 or let's say 10 collective exercises so far, all come to a sum of where they improve everybody's ability to deliver a good live performance in the microphone or on stage.